Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.
Hello, welcome once more. This is Berks Perspectives. I'm Fred Levering. I'm here in the studio beginning to get a complex that nobody joins me. I took a shower. I'm wearing pants. I don't know. I don't understand it. But nevertheless, we have on the Zoom patrol today the rest of our team. John Forrester is with us. John?
Fred.
Hi. Martha. Oh, that's Ruth. Ruth Martelli. And we have Martha with a different background this week, I see. And yes. Fred Opalinski is in there back from the wars, I understand. You were injured over the weekend or something, is that right?
Fred? No sound, Fred.
What? Is Fred O there?
Yes, I turned on my mic. I was just going to say I'm glad you're wearing pants, but that's...
Well, I'm glad that you're back from your adventures or whatever, so... there's an awful lot happening. I mean, I have a great news announcement. Wednesday is the 1st of July. We're halfway through 2020. Fine, you know, I mean, my God, what else can happen? But things are really, really happening fast. I'll give you a report from the real estate wars. We find ourselves now reopened and quite busy. Residential real estate is at one of the oddest junctures I've ever seen in my long tenure in the business. I've been in the business since the mid-70s. We presently actually have more licensed realtors in Berks County than we do residential listings. The total residential listings are in the mid-600s, and our membership is nearly 1,000. I mean, I've never seen such a thing. Commercial real estate is what you might expect. I mean, retail is awful. I mean, renting off retail space is difficult right now. It was bad enough with Amazon and the rest of the internet cohorts, but now with the shutdowns and stuff, it's gonna take some years for that to sort out. Office space is kind of curious. It's some offices are reopening and actually want more space so that they can do their distancing in the office. Others have discovered that, hey, we can work from home pretty effectively, so they're not looking for more space and are not looking to renew what they already have. The demand for industrial space, though, is high. I don't know if this is a matter of, one of the responses to the pandemic of manufacturers coming back to America or whatever it is, but there's a lot of demand on the industrial side. So it's a changing, fast-paced thing. But the point here is that things are happening very quickly, whether it be in real estate, in the news. We have one thing after another we've been discussing the last couple of weeks with the events of the pandemic itself, but then the economic fallout, then of course the civil unrest as a result of the murder of George Floyd in Minneapolis. We've got the elections looming, and a lot to talk about there. There have been some major Supreme Court decisions made. And then we have the overarching stories of just America. I mean, I'd like to start there today, if we may. You know, we hear a lot of stories about racism and so on. What's our take in our guest panel here? Is America a racist place, or are there some racist people among our 325 or so million folks? What do you think? John, you're never lack opinion. What do you think on that?
Okay. I think, yes, I think America is and always has been a racist country, society. And even those who profess not to be racist are, by definition, racist. And this is a problem that I think is now about to be resolved. And if we stick to it and don't lose our heads. It's going to resolve itself.
Well, let's dig into that one just a little bit before we hear from our other panelists on that subject. But you said that it's a society problem. So therefore, is it safe to say that police departments in general are not racist but have some bad actors? Or is it deeper in that aspect of public service than society in general? John?
I think it's much deeper. Police is just one sector of society. If I'm running a bodega and some black men walk in, I'm going to be watching them more than if an elderly white woman walked in. There's just suspicion. But black people, the black community is also racist. They don't trust the white community. They don't trust white, the power brokers. The power is in the hands of the white, old white men.
Well, Fred didn't ask for other opinions, but
a quarter step ahead of me. Go for it.
I was just thinking, there have been studies done about the way black children are treated as early as nursery school and elementary school compared to white kids. They are much more apt to be sharply disciplined, not overlooked, called to task, and kids growing up in that environment when they're always on the wrong side, that's got to scar your sense of self and relationship to others and all the rest. I mean, it starts at a very early age when kids are labeled because of their skin color. And their schools are generally speaking not as well supported because we rely on property taxes to provide income for the schools. They begin at a minus point, and that minus point is almost never erased.
Ruth, pick up on that.
No, I was just, there's a book out about Freddie Gray in Baltimore, who was underweight at birth, addicted to heroin, was raised in a public housing community where lead-based paint had never been remediated, so that as a young adult, the amount of lead in his blood was for the most part crippling in terms of his mental state and growth. So he was socially promoted because he didn't have the mental capability of dealing with learning. So by the time Freddie Gray was 16, or at the time of his death, he was in the minus category in terms of options open to him as a young man. And I think that's the kind of systemic racism that John is alluding to.
I agree. I think this country was based on an economy that depended on slavery. The country is a racist country, and we are all, if we look deep inside of ourselves, racist to one degree or another. Things that we have said that have been racist, not necessarily about the color of people's skins, but their nationality. I think this is a societal problem. The police, I believe, are generally the result of that society, that racist society. They, I believe, attract people who are racist, who are bullies. That's not everybody, but I would think the majority. And so getting back to your original question, yes, I believe we have a racist society, and we need to do a lot of work to work it out, because there's some very, very ugly things that are coming out right now in the news that people are doing and saying to other people. Just incredible. The freedom of speech, we certainly are taking to its nth degree.
Well, I've got a friend who is Chinese American, lives in New York City her whole life. And we've been together off and on quite a bit. Anyway, she has shared stories about the abuse that she received in New York. This is long before the onslaught of COVID-19. But times when she was afraid to leave her apartment and because she's an Asian-looking woman. And I mean, it is deeply ingrained in us, and you don't need to scratch very, very far below the surface to have that ugliness coming out.
I just finished reading a book called Saigon by a young Vietnamese man. His name is Phuc Tran. He came here when he was 2 years old to Carlisle. And he has written a book about growing up and going to school in redneck Carlisle. And it is, when you read that, you realize how much more racism there is around us than just black-white racism. And the things that he went through and how he dealt with them and how his parents dealt with him. It's an incredible book. Gone, of course, Saigon, but these are the two English words. And I urge you to read it. If you want to think of racism from another perspective, do pick it up and read it. It's a quick, good read.
Thanks for that.
My ancestors suffered, and when we came as the Irish, you know, somebody put up a picture of, it was a fake picture, trying to say that Irish immigrants were slaves. Or Germans were persecuted in World War I and World War II in this country. Italians were forbidden to go places in this country. But the difference between Black and Hispanic and Asian people is that Italians and Irish and other white ethnic groups, you can look at them and not know if you're Irish or Italian or Polish or whatever. Whereas it's pretty hard to disguise the fact that you're Black. So I know for a fact in schools, judgments are made about kids and expectations about what to expect from kids is often based on what color their skin is. And whether we do that consciously or we do it unconsciously, the prejudice is there. And when we expect less of kids of color, we're really putting a stumbling block in their path.
I want to come back to this theme here in one half a minute here, but I do want to say one thing about what Ruth, you commented on the lead-based paint causing an issue that wasn't remediated. Lead-based paint is an issue in the real estate business. We have to disclose and notify people about it, and it's really any property built prior to 1978 is when lead-based paint was deemed a problem. Up to that point, it was considered top quality and was outlawed. And it took a couple years to get it off the shelves and stuff. But in particularly Redding, but in a lot of Berks County, there are thousands of homes that were built prior to 1978, obviously. And we have a lot of lead-based paint. And I can tell you, from the front lines of real estate, that there are relatively few of them that have actually been remediated, where the paint's been removed, which can be done, very labor intensive and so on, which therefore translates to a lot of dollars. So it doesn't happen very often. It's generally what we refer to as being encapsulated, meaning it's been painted over many times, multiple times, but nevertheless painted over, but it's still there. So remediation is not something that is likely to ever happen in its totality at all. So that's just an aside on that. But
I mean, if housing is substandard and has lead paint and you've got flaking paint, if a property is well maintained and you've got three or four or five coats of paint over top of the lead paint, likely not any mishaps going to occur. But if you've got paint that's peeling and on the floors and the kids are putting it in their mouths, that's a very different thing. And that's what happens in a lot of places that are not well kept up.
Well, and what happens is you scrape over it a little bit to get rid of what's ever loose, and then you start painting over it again. But what the point I wanted to come back to now to follow up on the original thought here was, is America unique in this level of the racism that we've all expressed here, or is it hardly any different in other countries? Is that a human nature thing, or is it American society thing? Ruth, lead off on that, please.
Well, I think that often, Martha was a teacher as well. I think most elementary age kids, like kindergarten, first, and maybe up until about third grade, color is pretty much irrelevant to them. Once they get a little bit older, I think there's peer pressure that you hang out with your group, and you have to be a little bit more circumspect about who you invite to parties and that sort of thing. But I think if you look at the documents of our founding, and you look at why we are what we are, it's all based on the Declaration of Independence and the Constitution. Because we could only become a country if we were willing to turn a blind eye to slavery. And those Christian men who permitted slavery to happen, who made fortunes on the back of black men and women, perverted their faith beyond belief in order to make us believe that God created blacks to be our servants, that they were inherently inferior to white people and consequently could be treated as property and chattel. I think we were one of the few places in the world where slavery was perpetual. In other countries, you're a slave until you die, but your slavery didn't affect your children. Whereas here, slavery was generational.
Well, there is a little bit another aspect to that, and that is that, and you had touched on it early on about Irish. Back, actually, I think before most of the black slave trade took root, there was a lot of Irish, where the English literally emptied a lot of prisons in Ireland and deported those people into slavery, mainly into the West Indies, but also into southern part of the United States. And then, after they no longer had the ability to support their families, then they shipped the wives and children out the same way.
It's an urban legend that has been proven false. Now, the potato famine caused a huge influx of Irish, but there was no slavery. There was indentured servitude, but it wasn't slavery.
Nope, that's been proved to be, as John says, it's a lie. It's an urban legend to try to make Black Lives Matter not matter so much.
But what's the difference between indentured servants and slaves? I mean,
indentured servants were free after 7 years of labor.
I actually have a certificate. My father, who went to Wyoming Polytech and Penn State and did his apprenticeship there, and he has a certificate of indenture when he did that. So, I mean, I think the indenture was simply an obligation to spend so much time at a certain place to pay off whatever it was investment they had in training you. But Fred, you asked a little while ago, we never quite answered the question, what's it like in other countries? I think in many other countries, and the only one I can really speak of that I know for sure is Italy. My best friend, who is now passed, was a black woman that I met in Italy. She's American, She encountered no prejudice, no discrimination in Italy. In Italy, it was regional. The prejudices were depending on whether you were Northern or Southern Italian. And I think that's more often the case in a lot of European countries where the prejudices against certain people are more depending on where they come from in that part of the country, whether they are of a certain region, that there is more prejudice that than the color of your skin. There was none in Italy as far as the color of her skin was concerned.
Well, in very old Italy, in the days of Rome, when a Roman legion defeated another army, they brought the conquered army back to Rome as slaves. I mean, slavery is nothing new. I mean, this was something going on for centuries in our human history.
It's the same, Fred. That was a defeated army. Nothing like that happened with blacks who were brought to this country. They were either kidnapped or the white people traded arms, mostly arms, to take black slaves from black chiefs and what have you. But those Roman slaves were not slaves. When they died, that was done. They were over. Our friend, I don't know who else on the panel knows John Foster. Foster, not John Forrester. But John Foster is a really tremendous guy, wonderful actor, Toastmaster, speaker. And he has the document that shows that his, I think, great-great-grandmother was bought for $1,500. He has her manuscript of manuscript. And then she went on to become the, not wife because it couldn't happen, but she bore, I think, 14 children to the man who bought her. But she was still chattel slavery. She was still a piece of property with no rights and no realization that she was in fact a human being. That's what makes slavery in this country so insidious.
Fred O., I'm interested to hear your thought on that.
I know that prejudice exists in many other countries, and sometimes it is against blacks. I mean, some Northern European countries are not so welcoming to black folks. But I don't know of other places where it was so much a part of the foundation and the economic necessity as it was in the United States. For those first number of centuries, we had to have slaves in order to maintain the economy in the South and to some degree in the North. When slavery, with the Emancipation Proclamation, it really wasn't an end to the oppression of blacks because whites in power found other ways to oppress them, whether it was in minimum wages or whether it was in voter suppression. That has continued. And it seems more built into the system here than just about anywhere else I know. I mean, you've got the whole business of apartheid in South Africa, and that's quite a different process. But I think that's a part of our problem because it has just been for so long the case that blacks were second-class citizens if they were thought of as citizens at all. I mean, for a long time, they were equal to two-thirds of a person. And then we get to the point more recently when the Supreme Court says we no longer need voter rights legislation, and you see what happens almost immediately. States find ways of circumventing black votes, and that's going on to this very day. I mean, most recently in Kentucky and Georgia. So I was naive enough when Barack Obama was elected to think, oh my golly, we have come to a new chapter in this country's history. We have a black president. We can, in a way, leave all of this stuff behind. Little did I know that for 8 years, that racism was just seething and waiting to get out. And lo and behold, Donald Trump comes on the scene and provides all sorts of opportunities for it to blow its steam. A long way to go.
The history of slavery is extensive and interesting, and we could discuss it for hours. However, I'm more concerned with what we're going to do going forward.
Absolutely.
How do we get a dialogue going that's going to convince people that all men and women are created equal?
Well, and a question of what is the right response even in today's time now. That's the obvious next subject for us to take a hard look at, but I've gotten the high sign that we're down to about a minute and a half here. Our time has flown by once more. So I think we're going to have to save some of these thoughts for next week as to, you know, now that we've had the discussion of whether it's the prejudice is real. You know, now what are we going to do about it? And, you know, how do we go forward with that? So I think we're going to have to hold that for next week as the time is just about gone now. Does anybody have any other thoughts
yes,
that they'd like to throw in before we part?
On a positive note, congratulations to Redding's Mayor Eddie Moran for his wacky Water Wednesdays that he is bringing in. I thought it was a great article. It's a positive thing. Another positive thing that's happening in Reading, in spite of all the chaos that's going on around us, there are people who are really trying to move forward. And obviously our mayor is one of those. There's even a picture of him in his swimming trunks and t-shirt out enjoying the fire hydrant, the water and the fire hydrants. And every Wednesday there are different fire hydrants that are going to be open, because when he was a kid, he enjoyed that happening in New York City, and he wants the kids in Reading to experience that happiness too. So that's my shout out at the end of our show.
Well, that's a great ending, and I can't help but ask whether, Ruth, you're the only city resident in the group here. Have you been out in the fire hydrants yet?
Fred lives in the city as well.
Oh, that's right. Yes, up in Hamden Heights, or in Hessian Camp. So have either of you been in the fire hydrants?
I haven't been to the fire hydrants, but I really do applaud the mayor. In many ways, he has had a great first half year, I think.
Yes.
One of the most fun things is to be in Philadelphia outside of City Hall, where the fountains come out of the sidewalk. Yeah. And see little kids jumping over them, being splashed by them, throwing water at their friends. And it reminds me, in a much more simple way, of that kind of joyous freedom. So, yes, I think it's a lot of fun.
Neat. Well, that's a great way to end things, I think. So to our audience, we always can't tell you how much we appreciate having you join us. And we look forward to having you join us again next time, as we're going to take a further look at these. And I'd like to get into talking some more about the upcoming election as well, which I think is a next logical kind of, story to follow up on. So thanks for joining us. Have a great week. Have a good 4th of July, and see you soon.
Berks Perspectives on BCTV is supported in part by a friend of BCTV.